All right, guys. So I'm going to teach my move today, my last move of the year. Will be the move that didn't save me, but it gave me the affirmation that I needed to tell myself that I felt like I was a black belt. Okay, it didn't come from competition. I competed much when I was lower belts. But I was never a successful competitor. Never had the money to compete often. And the school I came from, we were focusing playing Gracie Jiu-Jitsu, Jiu-Jitsu for self-defense. So we never performed well in competition. I won a couple tournaments, but we were never successful in competition. And only years later, I found out why. And when I decided to teach, I knew that I had to change something. So I pursued the competition aspect of Jiu-Jitsu after I even got my black belt. And teaching wise, I feel good about it because we built a winning team, the winning team that I never had, I never belonged to. I was always like envy those Gracie teams. You know, I thought I was a name. Oh, we don't have the Gracie name. I think that's why we're not good. You know, it was not that. It's just we're doing Jiu-Jitsu for self-defense and we're trying to win tournaments with those techniques. They're different, okay? However, those techniques, with that said, were the techniques that allowed me to sustain myself in America after I moved. Because I was 135 pounds, I had to prove myself every day in martial arts schools around here against the average big American guy that weighs 200 pounds every day, 10 in a row, you know? So I used to do all that stuff inside the mat. Inside the dojo, you know, every day for years and years and years. So thankful to this foundation that I had built, I was able to build a school here. Okay, because it's just because you're from Brazil or just because you have a black belt, that doesn't mean you're going to build a team, build the movement that we have here today. So you have to have a good foundation. You have to be smart a little bit to make decisions along the way, and it's been about 10 years in Sarasota, right? 10 years from scratch, from going to the community center, putting the puzzle mats there underneath here together, and take them out apart every day, before and after every class, pile them up, going home. Next day we do the same thing with 5-6 students, and today we have this, you know. So, all because of the foundation, you know. With that said also, I had my 15 minutes of fame that I always wanted. You know, and it was a special day for me. I was attending a Royce Gracie seminar in Naples with a couple of friends here, right after I moved. And it was in a big high school gymnasium. There was 200 people attending that seminar. It was Saturday and Sunday. Saturday was no gi, Sunday was gi, 3 hours each day. So I never had done no gi jiu-jitsu before, ever, never had a no-gi match. That was back in 2002. I was visiting, and I didn't even move here for a good decade. So, and then the first day was a no-gi day. I was like, okay, let's do it, and I did. And in the end of the seminar, everybody sparred, and there was a black belt under Royce. He was my size. So out of the 200 people, we're the only ones that had a perfect match. And I could tell that everybody was waiting to see us fight, you know, as an American guy. And before I fought him, I was watching him, he was doing foot locks and leg locks on everybody, which is a technique that we don't do much in Brazil. I found the old school in Brazil that if you attempt a foot lock in a tournament, the whole stadium would boo. We think it's dirty, we don't like it, you think it's cheap, you know. But after Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu came to America, Americans liked that a lot, and it was incorporated. There's even a funny fact. I remember competing in a Pan Am in 2001, and the night before in LA, the night before in the hotel room, Mario Yamazaki, the UFC referee, he was with his team there, and he started running through the halls, yelling to everybody, foot locks and leg locks are allowed. Will be allowed in this tournament. Everybody was like, what? We don't do that. No, Americans like. And it was so strange for us the Yamazaki didn't even know how to say leg lock in English. Because we say your arm bar, we say arm lock. Because you think it's cool, it's in English in Brazil. Arm lock, arm bar, we say arm lock. It sounds cool. We like American stuff, we like English. And but because nobody knew leg lock, he used to say, arm bar of leg will be allowed tomorrow. Just so you can understand how naive this game was for us. So back to the story. The highest black belt guy was beating everybody with leg locks, and I was scratching my head like, no gi and leg locks. I was like, oh my god, now it's gonna be bad. And I don't know, you know, we'll see it. So, and then when we start fighting, everybody stopped fighting. I could tell everybody was waiting to see. And Royce Gracie was his student. He was not any black belt attending the center. He was his student. He was like riding on top of us watching the whole thing. Right? A lot of pressure. And Royce is my idol. I started doing jiu-jitsu because I went to the Blockbuster in Brazil and I rented the VHS UFC 1 and I watched at home. I was like, wow, I wish I'd do this one day. And then about a year or two later, my brother came home and he said, hey, I took a jiu-jitsu class. You gotta do it, I'm signing you up. And I did. But I watched twice on VHS. I was like, man, this guy's Superman. I wish I had this knowledge. So that was a big moment for me, you know, in Naples. And as soon as we start fighting, that guy went for a foot lock with me. And Matt, let me borrow it so I can show you what was happening. So sit down here for a minute, please. For foot locks and leg locks, there is, like what Thunder was saying from the bow and arrow choke, there's always a way to use to add an extra power and you go for the kill. Like for example, in a triangle choke, it's like pulling the head down, boom, you know, that's the extra power right there. An arm bar, it's like you got the arm bar and if you really want to break someone down, you boom, you bridge and you get that up. You know, there's always this extra little that you can go. For foot locks, there's also the extra. Once you get this normal foot lock here, if I really want to hurt you, and I don't want to give you time to tap out, and that was legal back in my time, you cross his leg over here, violently, over the knee here.
Yeah.
Today, this is illegal in BJJ. It's what we call the knee ripping. See, oh, look at the name, knee ripping. But that was okay back in the time, and that is okay in MMA, in someone's
sambo,
street.
That's how I learned it in sambo. It was,
sambo,
like, it was crossing like that.
Crossing
that.
Yes. Yeah. So, and I remember one day, now Matt, sit up and get my foot in for me, please. I remember one day, my professor, Master Paul, he was showing us this technique, this counter to the knee rip. And I never used that at all, because in Brazil we don't do that to each other. But it was, I had retained that. It was in my mind. So when I was fighting that guy, somehow I remembered that he needed me. And I knew that that guy would get me because he was good at it. He was really good. So I prepared myself to use it. So the defense is this, consists of this. You leave your hand on top of your leg, and when the foot cross over, go all the way over, I just go from the front and I do a gable grip here. That's it. I win. It's like he put me in check, but I checkmate him right after. So that's the beauty of it. So when I was fighting the guy, I knew he would get at this point. That I knew. He was competent to get that. And I knew, okay, if I let him do it, he was going to do it because that was okay. And that's how everybody did. So as soon as he got me there, I immediately did this. And I pretend my arm was dead here. You know, I was here trying to do the basic defense to it. As soon as it crossed, I caught him here, tap out. Man, I got up like a superhero. Like, Royce had his jaw broken right there. That's cool. And after that, I beat him 5 times in 5 minutes. And he never attempted the foot lock again. And that's why I was able to open up that score. Because if he was insisting on the foot lock, probably I would have won. But because he neutralized, he deleted that from his brain, he said no more. he went to fight me with the jiu-jitsu that I was good too. So I triangled him probably 3 or 4 times on top of that and I finished him. And the beauty of that is that after that, people wanted to take pictures with me. And on the next day, was a G-Day, guess who picked to fight me? Royce Gracie himself. And he totally destroyed me. And I loved it. That was so cool. That was my 15 own minutes that I did, you know? So that's the story, that's the technique. Let's go.
Thank you, man.
Let's go, guys. 7 times each.